First of all, thank you all very much for coming, and a special hello to everybody who's watching the live webcast of this. I think I speak on behalf of everybody in this room that they wish they too were at home with a bottle of wine and something to eat, and the ability to walk out at any point without being noticed. Actually reminds me, there's a story about the architect who was once invited to a small American town to present his work, and he arrived early in the morning, and the room was full, and the air was fresh. But as the day went on, the crowd got thinner, and the room got hotter, and he finally came on about 4 o'clock. By then, there's maybe 25 people left in the room, and as he's talking one by one, people discreetly climb out of the room, and to the point there's one fellow sitting in the second row. At which point he stops and says, look, this is silly. I'm happy to stop talking and you can go home. The fellow says, I can't go home. I'm the next speaker. So for those of you at the back, if you can't read these cartoons, on the left we have the public investment in the highway system and the wasteful subsidy going to the public transit. The people next to them are unable to afford an affordable home. The realtor is showing somebody here a 300 square foot unit, but she assures the potential buyer that with sliding walls, it's easy to make it feel like 1,200 square feet. In the middle, you have the baby boomer's house. Next to it is the little shack for Generation X, and Generation Y's tent is beside that. The cardboard box is $500 a month. The sign is announcing a new development. I believe it's 25% affordable housing and 75% unaffordable housing. And the last one is the Goldilocks approach to housing planning and density. The top one's a little too not dense enough. The middle one's too dense, but the middle bottom one is just right. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about tonight. For those of you who may have seen the first two talks, this one is going to be a little bit different because this year I turned 70. And I thought it would be worthwhile to look back 70 years at the various housing programs that were delivered in the city of Vancouver by the various levels of government in the hope that this will help us get a better appreciation of how we might manage to create more affordable housing over the next 70 years. And in between that, what I want to do is also take a look at the components of the housing cost. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with the word redux, it's basically meaning to bring back. And I thought it was appropriate because as we look to the future, I think there are indeed a lot of lessons from the past. So let's get started. In 1946, a year before I was born, CMHC, which was my employer for 10 years, was created. And it was really created to try and accommodate the growing population, and especially those who'd come back from the war. And I don't know how well you can see those numbers, but I thought I would start off by depressing you by pointing out that if you bought a house at that time, your average monthly payments, including insurance, taxes, maintenance, and repair, would be $53 a month. And for that, you got a detached single-family house, but it was a smaller house. It was 736 square feet. What I found interesting is even back then, discussions were taking place as to the planning of our region. And if there is one message I have throughout tonight, it's so often we talk about housing prices and housing affordability, we often tend to focus on the city of Vancouver. But I think it's much more important for us to look what is happening throughout the region and indeed even beyond the region as well. In 1947, CMHC published a book of house plans. And again, as you look through them, rarely do you find plans showing houses with two or three or four bathrooms. Homes like this, again, 730 square feet on a level that got you two bedrooms, a bathroom, kitchen, dining, living, with the provision to one day expand up into the second floor. And some of you would have heard Avi Friedman when he was here a number of years ago with his presentations on the grow house, the whole notion that perhaps what we need are more starter homes which can expand over time. I should mention at this point that while I was at CMHC, we did develop a program in Moncton, New Brunswick, known as the Shell House. And the idea there was that we would finish the house on the outside, but much of the inside would be left to the individual to finish off over time. And what I remember was a great debate between the local manager and the CMHC head office managers and architects, who felt that if they were finishing off the outside of the house, it was also important to finish off the landscaping and put on some grass. And the manager said, you know, I don't think this is necessary. Well, the head office insisted. And the reason I always remember this is when I went to see these shell houses as they were first finished, you could tell which ones they were. They were the only ones with lawn on the front lawn. It was about this time that many of the apartment buildings that we see today were being financed through CMHC. And it's quite interesting to look back, because in the beginning, CMHC was providing guarantees to the lenders. And then after a while, they then started to guarantee the rents to the builders. But the point is, all the rental housing, even back in the 50s, was really the result of CMHC programs that were applied across the country. One of the other programs that many of you have heard about is the capital cost appreciation, which allowed doctors and dentists and others to invest in rental property and then write off some of the losses and depreciation against their personal income. And that was a great way to get money flowing into the production of rental housing. And I'll show you another example of that later on. And indeed, it may well be something we want to consider for the future. The other small thing I'd invite you to look at is in the bottom right picture, you'll see the parking at grade. That one had garages, most didn't have garages, but I think the key point is none of these affordable buildings had underground parking. And if you want to see, or most of them didn't have underground parking, and if you'd like to see a nice collection of these 50s and 60s buildings, just go to Marple. And keep this image in your mind, because later on I'm going to show you a new vision for Marple. It was about this time that the federal government started building public housing projects across the country. The first one was in Montreal. The first one in Vancouver was the Little Mountain Project, which many of us know only all too well. It's the one that used to be there. There is some social housing that's been built, but we're all still waiting for that site to be redeveloped. And to my mind, it's a tragedy what has happened with the Little Mountain site, because I was always hoping that it could become a model of how we could begin to redevelop some of these older public housing projects across the country. Indeed, one of the last things I worked on before I left CMHC in 1981 was a report to management called The Regeneration of Older Public Housing Projects. In a past talk, I showed examples of Regent Park in Toronto, which is now being very successfully redeveloped. But in the future, as I will show, I think many of these older public housing projects offer great potential for increasing the supply of rental housing, affordable rental housing. It's interesting that in the 1960s, that was the first time when the number of multifamily starts actually outpaced the number of single family starts in metropolitan Vancouver. And that surprised me, because so often we read in the newspaper how multifamily has taken over from single family, but indeed it happened before. The other thing that was significant was in the 60s, it was when BC Housing was first created, and of course they play an important role when we look at the history of the affordable housing in this province. As the 60s progressed, of course, houses started to get larger. They no longer were 836 square feet. The other thing is they started to have basements, and that was terrific to see. Is that a City of Coquitlam shirt you're wearing there, sir? Where'd you get that? Oh, City Hall gave it to you. It's nice to see the mayor of Coquitlam join us. Thank you very much. The one of the my favorite developments for the 60s was this one, and some of you will know that Moishe Safdi, he won the CMHC Traveling Scholarship in 1965, and by 67 he had done his thesis building out this modular housing project in Montreal. I won the CMHC Traveling Scholarship in 1970. I also focused on modular housing, but it took until this year, last year, for a modular housing project in conformance with my thesis to get built. But I was pleased that the modular housing that you now see at Terminal and Main, the notion of relocatable modular units, was my thesis. But unfortunately, I have not had quite the career that Safdi has had. The 70s was perhaps the most significant decade in many respects, because at this point, many people were beginning to think that this whole approach of urban renewal, of freeway expression, development of freeway expressways, the wiping out of older neighborhoods and replacing them with public housing projects was not the way to go. And so we started to see some new attitudes towards urban development, especially in the city of Vancouver. And it was at that time that I arrived, and yes, that's me on the left. And one of the projects that I remember taking great pride in was this energy demonstration project proposed by Jacques Curie, who went on eventually to work with then City Enterprises. But this was a co-op on Broadway with a Trump wall, and it really was quite an innovative project for its time, and no one at CMHC wanted to support it, but I thought it was a good idea. And the irony is, I think it looks better today than it did in 1975 when it was finished. But it was about that time that the public housing programs were replaced by a number of National Housing Act programs. Section 15.1 of the National Housing Act referred to the nonprofit organizations. There was also provision for municipal nonprofit. And in fact, the City of Vancouver created a nonprofit at that time. It was headed up by a gentleman named Morris Jeroff, who came here from Winnipeg, and the city did a number of projects. So it's ironic that it got started then and then went dormant up until quite recently. There was another program, Section 3418, that allowed these par-value subsidized housing cooperatives to get going. And indeed, Vancouver area was one of the most active parts of Canada when it came to the development of co-op housing. The other thing was a number of new rent supplements programs were introduced, which provided subsidies to people who were in need on the understanding that they could then choose to live wherever they wanted. And I could remember sitting in the beer hall with my colleagues from CMHC often debating, is it better to be building affordable housing with subsidies, or is it better to give the money to the individuals? And of course, that's a conversation that is still going on. And indeed, I often hear Rich Coleman say, from his point of view, it's preferable to you get more bang for the buck giving money to the individuals. I agree with it, except for one thing, and that is, if the type of housing that those individuals are seeking isn't available, then you have to look at supply-side programs. One of the highlights, I think, for me during this period and many others at CMHC was seeing the proliferation of a number of seniors' housing projects. And I used to be surprised. I would go into Kelowna, and there everything was two or three stories, except for the seniors' project that was 14 stories. And confused me until one year I was invited to speak at a Kiwanis annual conference, And at the beginning of one of the sessions, people around the room would stand up and say, I am George Robertson, and I'm the president of the Windsor chapter, and we just completed a 12-story building. And then someone else would get up and say, I'm from London, Ontario, and we just completed a 14-story building. Indeed, these people were all competing on the height of their seniors' projects. On the right there is a building, a complex some of you will recognize. Roger Hughes was the architect for the Pacific Heights Co-op, and it was an innovative project in that a number of older houses were moved forward, and then a new infill building was constructed behind. And I always challenge people to go by that project and take a close look at the older houses, because during the movement, one of them collapsed, and it was completely rebuilt from scratch. And I challenge anyone to figure out which one it is. Around this time, Dave Barrett became the premier, and it was out with the Socred government and in with the NDP government, and there were some dramatic changes when it came to housing policy. Some of you will know the name Michael O'Dayn, president of Polygon, or chairman today of Polygon Homes. At the time when I met Michael in 74, he was the advisor to the then Minister of Housing, Lorne Nicholson. That was his background. Dunhill was created at that time. Michael went on to buy Dunhill with some friends later on, which gave him a little bit of a head start. But there were a number of co-ops built at this time, and it really was quite a significant period. The other thing, of course, is this is when we introduced rent control. And I think at some point we should have more of a conversation. Many of you may have seen an article. Councillor Cameron forwarded it to me today. A financier, banker in Toronto is speculating on whether or not rent control really is serving the best interests of the people it's supposed to help. But the other thing, of course, that was happening is that we put an end to the construction of the freeways, although those viaducts were there. And if Jeff Meggs is watching, I'm sure you'll assure us that they'll be gone soon. 71 to 75 was the period when the AHOP program was very active. And AHOP stood for the Assisted Home Ownership Program. And it's interesting that we've had a number of subsequent AHOP programs. But the key thing about this one was that there was preferential financing available to people buying homes provided they did not exceed a certain price. And the price in Metro Vancouver was $47,500. And what $47,500 bought you was a condominium developed by Dayon in the West End, or a single family house out in Cloverdale or other parts of the region. And I remember there was a great deal of debate in the CMHC office when one of the buyers of the single family homes complained that her house, while it had three bedrooms and a very nice bathroom, there were no doors on the closets. And she questioned whether this was truly livable. And I remember we met with the builder and he said, look, she's getting a house for $47,500. Over time, she can go out to the hardware store and buy her own closet doors. But I put this other slide up here of Vancouver LTD, because for those of you who are interested in the history of development in Vancouver and planning, this is a book by Donald Gutstein, who's still around. He was up at SFU. And Donald Gutstein wrote a really insightful report on the operations of the housing industry, particularly the development industry. It included photos of the homes of all of the principals of Dayon Developments and the other big development companies, and have juxtaposed those with the squalid living conditions of so many other people in the city. But I'm sure it's in the library, and I recommend it. And if anyone is interested and they can't find it, I'll happily lend you a copy. 1976, False Creek South Shore got underway. And believe it or not, it was extremely controversial. Indeed, half of council felt that this should be a park. Half of council felt that this should be housing. In the end, they did what most politicians would do. They made it half park and half housing. Art Phillips was the mayor. Walter Hardwick was the guiding spirit behind this development. And the South Shore of False Creek was significant to my mind because it represented the first major redevelopment of a derelict industrial area. The other thing is that a considerable attention was given to the socioeconomic profile of the residents. And as you can see, through a variety of public and private programs, one-third of the units were targeted to those in the low, middle, and upper incomes. And that was to try and replicate the socioeconomic profile of the region. Virtually every CMHC program was utilized to try and make this housing happen. The irony is that I was appointed the project manager for CMHC because everyone else in the office figured this project was going to fail and that it would not be a career-enhancing move to be in any way affiliated with it. And to be fair to them, at one point it looked like it might fail when the headline in the Vancouver Sun was "Instant Slum, Tar Paper Shacks." Remember, in those days we used tar paper instead of Tyvek. And there really was an incredibly negative attitude until then Mayor Art Phillips and his wife Carol Taylor announced to the city that they were moving into the community. And I really believe that was a significant step in the transformation of the public perception of what it is to live in this higher density forms of housing. And if you haven't spent any time, I highly recommend that you go for a walk through the South Shore of False Creek, because there you'll see many of the forms of housing that I think we still need. In fact, we need to build much more of it. Stacked townhouses, partially underground parking, very limited parking in other places. One of the reasons why we were able to reduce the amount of parking is because Doug Sutcliffe, the city project manager, and Art Phillips decided that transit would be in place the day the very first residents moved in. Well, of course, BC Transit said they wouldn't do that because it would cost them too much money. And Art Phillips, who some of you would know, was one of the founding partners of Phillips, Hager, and North, said, "How much subsidy would you require?" And they announced the amount. And he and Doug Sutcliffe and CMHC figured out that if we charged every unit $5 per month, we could raise the subsidy to have the bus service in place the day the very first residents moved in. And I mention that because today, if you go out to Maple Ridge and many other metro municipalities, we're still building housing without any public transit. And transit is not prepared to run those bus lines. And I would suggest that if they won't run the buses, then it may well make sense to look at that kind of approach. One of the other things that happened around this time was the very significant report by GVRD, the first livable regional strategic plan. I must say, I got tremendous delight reading all of these reports as I prepared this talk. But you can see that quotation on the right. I think you can read it. But basically, the point is, people were as worried about the high cost of housing in 1976 as many of us are today. Now, I can't comment on whether the crisis that we're facing, I think it is a crisis, is that much more severe. But I think it is to the extent that we are losing people, unlike in those days when people still came. But what is interesting is at the time the population was 1.2 million and it was projected to grow 30,000 a year. Now, if you accept that today the population is about 2.4 million, that's a 1.2 million increase over the last 40 years, which if you divide those two numbers, works out to exactly 30,000 a year. And when you look at the projections for the future, it's generally 30,000 a year. So it's quite interesting to see how accurate that some of those projections were. It was from the mid-70s until 1981 that another one of these incredibly effective rental housing programs got underway. The MER program, as many of you may recall, basically invited people to invest in a unit which would be rented out on the understanding that they would get a variety of tax shelter, tax write-offs, and so forth. And many would say it was a bit of an abuse when you looked at the amount of the write-offs. I remember my first day of work at NAROD Developments that built this project. Mel Grabinski came into my office and said, "Suite 202. And I said, "What?" He said, "202, that's your suite." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "You have to buy 202. I said, "What are you talking about? I don't even own a home." "No, no," he said, "everybody who works for the company has to buy a MERB." I remember, I said, "How much is it?" He said, "It's $126,000. I said, "$126,000? What about the down payment? I don't even have the down payment." "No," he says, "not a problem. We'll lend you the down payment." And I remember he brought me the papers, just like people all over Vancouver were getting similar papers. And I had to sign that I was a sophisticated investor with a net assets of $250,000. And I said, "I can't sign that." And they said, "Do you want to work here?" So I owned Suite 202, I think, until about 1988. One of the other programs that came about in the early 80s was the CRISP, as we called it. Again, another one of those federal rental housing programs. And it encouraged developers to build rental housing by offering low-interest loans. Now, the interesting thing about this is if you think back to the 1980s, the going rate for interest was around 22%. And so low interest rate loans were very attractive. The situation today is quite different. Our interest rates are very low. Unfortunately, our land values are extremely high. So just offering low interest loans in themselves may not be sufficient. Although I do understand that within the coming weeks, CMHC may be announcing a new rental housing program. Another thing happened in the mid-80s that significantly changed development in Metro Vancouver, and you know what it is. It was the beginning of the SkyTrain rapid transit system for our region. And I think it is interesting to look at the development that happened in large part because of the SkyTrain. One of my favorite developments was the waterfront of New Westminster, and there's a lot of stories that could be told about this. One of them is that many of those low-rise buildings in the front are social housing projects. The high-rises in the back are market condominiums. But the irony is that the developers like Boza and Andre Molnar weren't prepared to build those condos unless there was some inducement. And the inducement was they were allowed to build the social housing on behalf of nonprofits, and that's what made the whole thing happen. But it's quite an interesting story. This next building has a story, which I suspect a few of you know. Ray Spaxon knows this if he's watching. But the reason I thought this building was significant, because it tells a story about the times. This rather odd-looking building looks like this because the bottom is all office and the top is housing. And the reason it looks like that is because the city of Vancouver had a downtown density bonusing scheme. We called it the 4+1, but it could be 3+3. But basically what it said was, if you build one more FSR of office space, if you build one FSR of housing, we'll give you one more FSR of office space. Because at the time, people didn't want to build housing downtown, but they did want to build some office space. But the reason it's significant is, as some of you may know, in subsequent years, I think 1991, the whole building got converted to housing. And indeed, there's a number of office buildings downtown that have been converted to housing. And so now, you know, when you look at Telus Gardens and some places like that, the city was incenting developers to allowing them to build housing provided they built office. So in a few decades, the attitudes switched. It was at the late 80s, early 90s that the other major waterfront redevelopments started to take place. Cole Harbor, the North Shore of Falls Creek, the East End of Falls Creek, And Gordon Campbell was very involved in a lot of the decision making. And as some of you may recall, Gordon was a developer and he knew the business. And Gordon was genuinely interested in ensuring that since many of these developments were benefiting from rezoning decisions by government, that they should include affordable housing. And so the 20% philosophy came into place, where 20% of the units had to be some form of affordable housing. When it was first written, it required funding from the senior levels of government. And as it's illustrated here on the left, in the case of False Creek, the False Creek Co-op was built as part of that non-market component. I don't know if Cameron Gray here tonight? Cameron Gray was very involved in creating that non-market housing, low-income rental housing, Seaside. It was a very clever name, with the letter C. Maybe Cameron will tell us a little bit about that. And then the condo towers were built. The interesting thing, though, is that there was some debate as to whether this really was the best way to create integrated communities. And based on my experience with the South Shore of False Creek, at the time I was managing the redevelopment of the Bayshore project, and I really questioned whether we were doing anybody a great favor by having low-income families with children living in the Bayshore at the foot of Cardero Street. Now, I admit, I'm a snob, and part of my concern was having the laundry out on the balconies and things like that would detract from the attractiveness of the market condominiums. I also questioned, where is the infrastructure for low-income families in terms of shops and services? Those, they weren't going to go up to Robson Street or into the Bayshore for coffee. So I ended up discussing this with Jim Green, who at the time was the king of the downtown east side, who was trying to get the Woodwards project going. And we arranged to agree that if he was willing to support the removal of the requirement for low-income families at Bayshore, we would give him, I think it was $3 million as seed money for the Woodwards development. And it took a number of other years for Woodwards to be built, but I still believe that that was the right decision. We subsequently built the non-market seniors component that I'll talk about later. But one of the reasons I was concerned about the requirement to build the social housing was that I knew that very soon the federal government would be cutting off all of these social housing programs, and these sites could well end up lying fallow while we waited. And that's in fact what happened. In 93, as we constantly hear, the federal government cut the funding of all of that myriad of non-market programs that had delivered thousands of seniors and co-op and family rental units over the previous 20 years. And that same year, the agreement was reached between the federal government and the provincial government that the province would take over from CMHC the responsibility for housing. And so it's within that context that you should think about the conversations that are taking place today with Justin Trudeau and other federal officials. As the text says, this is a magnificent looking development. I think it's turned out to be an incredibly attractive place to live. But what you don't see here, if you walk around the site, is that behind those glassy towers are six weed-filled vacant sites. And those are the social housing sites that Concord Pacific had to set aside. And over the years, the money has not been there. And while you'd like to think that Concord, with all of its creative skills and ability, and the city could reach some sort of agreement to create some affordable housing, or perhaps a mix of affordable housing and affordable ownership housing and some market ownership housing on those sites. During the 90s, we also started to see more livable region strands and the plans. And the interesting thing is most of these plans really did build on the success of that 1976 plan, which I noted did not, it's a shame I didn't point that out before, it didn't suggest that Coquitlam should become a regional town center, but it did say that Port Coquitlam should become a regional town center. So you obviously scuppered that for Mayor Moore. A number of other large-scale communities were built. This transit-oriented development by Jack Poole's VLC properties that subsequently became concert properties is, to my mind, a very attractive example of a mixed-use community that is trying to provide accommodation tied to transit. And one of the highlights for me with this development was a report that went back to council seeking a reduction in the parking requirements for future phases, because by virtue of the location, the parking requirements were not as great as people felt initially would need to be put in place. One of the things that started to happen the next decade was the renovation of a number of SROs in the downtown east side. And when I was with CMHC, we did the first renovations of two hotels. Believe it or not, it was a major decision for CMHC's head office to agree that funding could go to rehabilitate these older hotels. But it turned out to be so successful that CMHC subsequently created a program called the RAP Rental, Residential Rehabilitation Assistance Program, which was used to rehabilitate other rental housing projects. Now, there are remnants of that program still around, but it's something to think about. My concern with this project, and indeed with a number of other projects undertaken by some nonprofits, was the cost. And in this case, the cost, Cameron told me he thought it was around $14 million. It was $14,365,000 for 44 suites and some ground floor retailing, ground floor community space. And it's a beautiful renovation, and Cameron knows all about it. But when you actually look at the size of the suites, it worked out to about $1,000 a foot of leasable area. Many people take for granted basement suites as the most affordable type of housing, but what they don't realize, it wasn't until 2004 that we legalized basement suites in single family houses. One of the things that always troubled me, if you go and look at my last two presentations, is that we have basement suites in houses, but we don't allow basement suites in duplexes within the city of Vancouver. They do in North Vancouver and some other municipalities. And we don't allow basement suites in townhouses, but we should. And that was some of the thinking behind the eco-density program that was launched in 2006. And I always felt that it got a bad rap. And again, it was politics that sometimes interferes with common sense. Sam Sullivan, to his credit, was very genuine in his desire to see how new development patterns could help save the planet. To be honest, I didn't share the same environmental concerns that he did. But when he invited me to be a part of the launch, I said I would do it, but on the understanding that we could also talk about the affordability benefits of eco-density. And I think it's worth taking another look at that charter, at some of the things it recommended. Laneway housing, densification along arterials, more townhouses, and so forth. It really was focused much more on the intensification of development with lower building forms. Because people didn't like Sam and they felt that he somehow personally benefited from trademarking the name, which he didn't, the program got a rap, bad rap. I once wrote a column because whenever I talked to people, they said, well, it's just high rises. And I said, no, density doesn't necessarily mean high rises. So hence the title, we get the eco, but what's density? Jonathan Baker, who was a city councilor, was very upset that I was out there preaching to people what density meant and wrote a very nasty letter to the editor that has hurt me to this day. Cameron Gray can tell you all about this when the city announced 14 sites for affordable housing. And again, it troubled me a little bit that these projects were so well designed and so beautiful compared to a lot of the market housing that was being built. But indeed, bit by bit, Cameron, have all 14 been built out yet?
All but one.
All but one. Well, it's only 10 years. Suzanne Anton, of course, is now our Attorney General, really was a driving force behind the laneway housing, and she often referred to it as her baby. The discussion at the time, though, was how affordable would these rental units be? I think this program has turned out to be very successful, and it's being emulated now in Toronto, Ottawa, many other cities across Canada, indeed North America, are looking at it. The Europeans aren't looking at it because they don't have that many single-family houses. But the fact is, I think it's a good program, and we can talk a bit more about it. The one thing I would like to see is the ability for some people to buy these small houses, not just rent them. The STIR program called a lot of stirring up of emotions when it was first announced. I don't know where I found that picture of the mayor. I shouldn't say this, but I look at that picture. I was once on CBC Early Edition with Rick Clough. I think it was around 2011, and he said, there's a rumor you're going to run for mayor. Are you going to run for mayor? And I said, if Gregor Robertson looked like me and I looked like him, I might run for mayor. The STIR program became very successful, despite a rough start, and quite a few units were built. Some of them were built as part of the condos, some of them were built as standalone rental. And while some can question, I think legitimately, how much density the city gave away to a few lucky developers, the fact is it did start to result in the delivery of rental housing in Vancouver in the absence of federal government programs. And it was the first time that it happened. 2012 is, I think, a significant year because that's when the mayor's task force convened and over the course of, I think, about 8 months, put together the task force report. And I often say this, I think if you need a Bible in terms of what we should be doing in Vancouver to improve housing affordability, just go through this report and the ancillary reports, page by page. And it's available online. You just need to Google the Mayor's Affordable Housing Task Force. But you know, one of the things that it talked about, which I think we need to still talk about, is how do you balance the desire to protect low-income renters with the opportunities to redevelop or renew some of that rental housing stock, much of which is getting older, and we'll talk about that. It talked a lot about streamlining the process, the planning approval process. And when I sat in council a month ago with Kay Krishna and Gil Kelly, I had to smile because their presentation is virtually a précis of the recommendations, many of the recommendations. I had the opportunity to work with the architects and the planners and the development community and the home builders to come up with a separate report that looked at how building form and design changes might improve housing affordability. And again, if you look at that whole document, I like to think that it touches on many of the things that we're talking about. How we need to rethink some of the single family zone lands. We need to take a fresh look at some of our building codes, many of which haven't changed in decades, even though we now can build far more fireproof buildings, we have sprinklers and so forth. We talked about different forms of town housing. We also took a look at some of the other more innovative ideas. David McClellan, who was deputy city manager at the time, was particularly interested in whether the city should be expanding micro suites. And if John Stavell is watching, he's still having that debate with the city. I think the conclusion of everybody who I spoke with was that micro suites are fine, but you might not want one building with 400 micro suites. You might want to sprinkle them out or mix them in with other larger suites. Parking standards, we discovered, was a major consideration affecting housing affordability, and that's a very cheeky picture, I know. And that last picture at the bottom there was to point out that the city needs to balance its sustainability requirements with its affordability requirements. That was the mechanical room of a stacked townhouse development. And by the time they fitted in all of the fire marshal's requirements and the sustainability requirements, they ended up building reservoirs in the basement of this development. It was wrong. 2013 saw the introduction, though, of another rental program, Rental 100, meaning 100% of the building is rental, and it's working. There's no doubt that a lot of people are building rental projects. What's not really working that much, though, or that well, is the interim rezoning policy, which basically said along certain arterials, and while I'm focusing on Vancouver, I'm really speaking about the whole region because many of the other municipalities look to Vancouver for ideas. But the whole idea in this case of encouraging rental housing up to six stories along arterial is a terrific idea, and it's happening. What wasn't such a great idea was saying we'd also support rezonings for affordable housing, providing the housing was 20% below market in perpetuity. And I don't think there's any lawyers who can draft those legal agreements. We'd all be happy to build housing that initially sold for 20% below market because we'd sell it to our daughters and our nieces and our friends. But to keep it in perpetuity 20% below market is tough. The other thing is 20% is just about the margin that most developers like to think of as their future profit margin. But I think the STIR program was working, the Rental 100 program is working, and the fact is we do need more rental housing, and some is coming. Remember that image of Marpole? Well, this is the new image of Marpole, and I think, you know, I can't believe people were out there wanting to stop the rezoning of Marpole. God knows what somebody told them. It made so much sense for them. If only in their own self-interest, the value of their property would have gone up. But who knows why? But anyway, we'll talk about that near the end. But certainly, I think the vision for Marpole is very, very attractive. It's part of the city that desperately needs regeneration. Another community plan that took a little longer is the Grandview Woodland. And by the way, even if you don't live in these neighborhoods, or you don't own property, or you don't work, it's worth reading these documents. Some of them are very well written, they're very thoughtful, and it says a lot about the planning, especially those of you who are working outside of the city of Vancouver. And indeed, throughout Metro, we are seeing some new plans being created. The district in North Vancouver has developed, as part of its OCP, a number of new higher density village centers, which I think are going to be very exciting. And similarly in Surrey and other municipalities, higher density neighborhoods are being created. There's not a lot of high density neighborhoods being created in West Vancouver, Councillor Cameron, but certainly we can get up to 0.6 FSR, I'd like to think, without too much difficulty. But in addition to all these supply programs, we've also seen efforts to create housing affordability through taxation policies and grants and so forth, and I'm going to move this through. But you can see them here, a number of different programs. Why do we still offer $1.6 million homeowner grants to people in Castlegar and $1.6 million homes? They don't need any help. If the province has that much money, why don't they use it to increase the shelter allowance from $375 a month? Changes were made to the property tax system that, too, I think, to some degree, made sense. Like, why burden people who are buying their first and a more affordable home to the same degree as people who are buying a $4 million home? The foreign buyer's tax, well, we talked about that last year. It's working, or at least it was working. I understand from talking with the editor of Real Estate Weekly that the market is slowly picking back up. Is that right? It's almost back to where it was, I'm told. One thing the provincial government has done, though, is it has invested a lot of money in new affordable housing. And I spoke to Jack Clarkson, if he's watching. He told me he's never been so busy. There's so much money available to help nonprofits build housing. The only problem is he can't get approvals through the municipal system. And the empty home tax, we can talk about that in the question period. The recent home buyer program, it's working, and I actually supported it because I do think, given the druthers, people should try to get into home ownership as soon as they can. Unless you have parents who can help you, it's very hard to raise that down payment. This program, I think, is working. Now, I'd like to quickly, often people say, why does housing cost so much? So let's take a quick look at the six components of housing cost. The first one is land. The irony is that if land is zoned residential in most parts of Metro, it has become so expensive that even if you can densify, gentle densification, build the missing middle, it's still expensive. I did a whole presentation, but I cut it out, showing if we could put two units on one lot, what is the land component? If you put four units, even if you put four townhouses on one lot, in many parts of Metro, you're still looking at $300,000 to $500,000 just land component. If you put 10-unit apartment on a single-family lot, the land component is still $120,000 to $200,000 per unit just for the land. So it's a real problem. When you look at the construction costs, there's a whole array of components of construction costs. The off-site requirements, the type of development, of course, influences it. A key consideration is the type of parking, especially if it's underground. And if it's underground, how many levels do you have to go down? The size of the unit impacts cost. Smaller the unit, as a general rule, higher cost per square foot. And of course, the standard of finishes. One of the things that I wanted to talk about was if we could get rid of all those granite countertops and get rid of the beautiful shower stalls and so forth, how much could we save? Well, the answer is, in the overall scheme of things, not very much. That's not necessarily going to do it. But we can save money by reducing the underground parking, and we can save money if the municipality doesn't assume that the developer will pay for all the off-sites. We can save money if we start looking at wood frame rather than concrete, and that's happening. And indeed, if we look at prefabricated construction, which I've been saying prefabrication construction is going to take off next year. I've been saying that since 1971. The soft costs. By soft costs, we're referring to the architect's fees, and of course, you can't touch the architect's fees. But all those other costs, the interesting thing is, on average, all those consulting fees, including the envelope consultant, the sustainability consultant, it's about 6% of the construction costs. I want you to remember that number. And then you look at all the other costs, the appraisal and insurance and so forth. And then you get to the municipal fees that we'll talk about later, and taxes during construction. So then the question is, well, how do we reduce those costs, or can we? Well, you know what? Realistically, you can't significantly reduce the consultant costs. The one way you could is if you don't have to do two or three different, completely different designs as you go through a rezoning process. The municipal costs can certainly be reduced if we could figure out alternative ways to finance growth. And certainly some of the other costs could be marginally. But realistically, we're not going to make great movement there. Marketing costs. Normally we think of marketing costs as part of the soft costs, but the interesting thing is I think they should be broken out. Because the sales revenue, and I invited all the marketing firms that I work with to watch tonight's presentation, and this is where they're going to go to the bathroom. But the sales revenue, the general rule of thumb here is a sliding scale, but it's around 3%. But then when you're doing a pre-sale program for a new high-rise, you're going to have marketing costs that could be anywhere from 2% realistically to 3-4%. So you're now looking at a total of between 5 and 7%. But that's 5 or 7% on the revenues. So, but if you took those costs And you look at them as a percentage of construction costs, like the architect's fees and the other fees, you're now at about 15%. So if only we could figure some creative ways to reduce marketing costs. Well, one way, I think, is if we didn't have lenders who are always insisting that the developers pre-sell before they lend them the money. If they're going to make money lending money, why don't they do some proper underwriting? Did you hear? I hope Canadian Western isn't watching. I got to speak to them about a loan very shortly. The irony is that the financing cost that used to be such a significant cost when I started in the business in 81, it's a relatively minor cost now. The only way to significantly reduce that is if you can reduce the time frame, for, especially for planning and approvals, because these days you don't really option land like we used to. You usually have to buy the land and then hold it. If we could access cheaper government money, like some developers appear to be able to do, according to Global TV, that will help reduce your costs. Or if you can reduce the time it takes for construction. The last component is the developer's profit. And the profit is significant. Sometimes we measure it as a percentage of revenues, sometimes as a measure of costs. But it certainly does, when you look at it, it can be very profitable. The last few years it's been profitable, but it isn't always profitable, indeed. You just have to look at all of the companies that went into receivership over the years, including my own, which my boss blamed me for. So how do we reduce profit? Well, one way is, I think, by trying to reduce the risk. And sometimes you can reduce the risk if you can see all of your future buyers or renters lined up in front of you. You can also reduce profit if, in fact, you look to the third sector. If you go back to those nonprofit developers, and that's a whole discussion that I think is starting to take place. But this is the key question. I'm asked all the time. Even if you guys can reduce your costs, if the municipality reduces its fees, will the price go down? And the answer is no, not necessarily, unless there are other considerations. And those other considerations are whether there's sufficient supply and competition in the marketplace, then prices will go down commensurate with costs. At least I believe that. So to conclude, I'd now like to see if we can pull this together and look at 9 different ways that we might start to create a little more affordable housing. And obviously the first one is we need to make better use of land. People say we're running out of land. We're not running out of land. We just don't make very good use of the land we already have. And I'm delighted to see the discussion that's taking place on how we can make better use of single family land. And it's taken a long time in Vancouver, but it's still taking longer in many of the other municipalities. The other land that we should be looking at is social housing and public housing projects, and land that's not zoned for housing, because that's cheaper land. So what do I mean by making better use of single family? Well, these were all highly controversial projects. Those two middle ones are some apartments that I worked on. They were complex rezonings. Today you can barely see the buildings. They're hidden behind trees. And yet in the case of the bottom one, I had to knock a floor off, which meant about 15 seniors didn't get a home. But townhouses, laneway houses, fourplexes and so forth, that's the sort of thing. I'm very proud of this project, and I'm particularly proud that Stephen Mikicic is here tonight, because he was the planner who believed that if I persisted long enough, I could convince West Vancouver residents that this wouldn't destroy West Vancouver. And thank God it didn't. But that's 3 units on one lot, 0.6 FSR plus basements, with coach houses along the lane and a little bit of a sense of community. So we now need to start looking at these social housing sites. There's been a lot of discussion in the media lately as to whether the government did the right thing selling them to nonprofits. I don't think so. I think they should have sold them to nonprofits and developers who had the resources and expertise to build both a mix of more affordable and other types of housing, but with a focus. One thing we're starting to see now is the regeneration of older rental housing. These are two developments that I worked on. The one on the left are the first rental housing units in over 40 years in West Vancouver. And as soon as the legal agreements are figured out between the lawyers and the bank as to whether or not the municipality should have a right to determine whether there's too many people living in a room, that project's going to get underway. The one on the right is a tragedy. That's Beach Towers. When I worked on it, we were going to do another tower that looked just like the other towers. The community said they didn't want high rise, and they thought by saying that, the developer would go away. Instead, he developed this plans for this mid-rise, which I think is far more intrusive than a slender tower would have ever been. But the other thing we need to talk about are these older rental housing projects, because we've got a real dilemma here. On one hand, they provide the most affordable rental housing other than basement suites throughout the region. On the other hand, the average age is now approaching 60, and there's no real incentive for a lot of the owners to repair them. And this is an issue that we're going to have to debate. The irony is that in the city of Vancouver, the rate of change bylaw effectively preserves a lot of these buildings and prevents them from being demolished. In other municipalities, it's the exact opposite, that anyone can come along and demolish these older rental buildings and put up condominiums. There has to be an answer somewhere in between. The other opportunity I see is industrial land. Oh, if Brent Todran was here, he'd say, don't be silly. If you allow residential on industrial land, it will force up the value of the land and we won't get industry. That's wrong. You could write a zoning bylaw that says, provided you build the maximum amount of industrial development, then you can build some residential development, which might actually bring some restaurants and shops into the neighborhood. Now, some will say, how can you mix housing and industry? Well, because housing and industry today is very different than industry in our grandfathers' days. Number two is we've got to review government support. Now, I think we all would say we've got to increase government support. We've got to bring back the kind of government support. I don't believe it's going to happen, but I think there are some things that are more realistic. And so let's just take a look at those. The first one is make publicly owned lands available for development, or in some cases, sell off some publicly owned land and then use the revenue. I've calculated that the city of Vancouver could probably get $200 million if it takes a portion of the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th holes at Langara Golf Course, which isn't a great golf course anyway. But think about some of the other opportunities, building on senior centers, building on community centers, looking at other lands. Fisheries is now making some of its land surplus in West Vancouver, and a debate's going to take place. What's the appropriate mix? To my mind, that should be developed with a mix of multifamily housing, including some affordable housing. But there's a chance it may end up as 5 single-family lots. But there's no doubt that there's an opportunity. I got into a lot of trouble for suggesting to people that if they couldn't afford their taxes, they should let Christy Clark pay them for them. My point here is the programs like this should be means tested. I don't need to take advantage of this government money. Better to use that government money to encourage somebody to build rental housing than to give it to me. Last year, I did very well with the $11,000 or $12,000 I saved on my Vancouver property taxes. I invested it and got over well over 15%. Now, here's something I don't talk about a lot, but I think we need to think about this. When you do get your tax bill, do you notice that there's no division between multifamily housing and single-family housing? And I've often thought that's wrong. Multifamily housing is consuming, in many instances, fewer services than single-family. So here's a picture of two of my houses. The one on the right is literally at the end of the line. It's on an island in the Fraser River. Miles of pipes and roads service it. The garbage truck has to drive for 20 minutes to get to me. And then on the left was a unit I had at the Bayshore development in a high density. And the taxes on the two units was almost identical because they were valued at the same. When you think about it, it's wrong. We should start to think about But helping people who are choosing to live in more sustainable forms of housing by reducing their taxes and burdening those people who are in single family. Did all of you who are watching this living in single family homes hear me say that? But we should, because it's when you go to Vietnam, you'll notice a lot of really skinny houses. That's because there the property taxes are based on the width of the property, because they reason. If it's less roads, less sidewalks, makes more sense. The other thing we've got to do, and again, we've heard this a lot, is simplify and improve the municipal approval system. And I won't dwell on this because you all know it. The one thing, though, I would like to see is why can't we start taking all those corner lots and single-family subdivisions and while waiting to do anything else, allow them to be subdivided into two or three? And then people could start putting 700 or 800 or 1,000 square foot houses on them instead of one 3,000 square foot house. And those municipalities who've got minimum suite sizes, rethink that. Is it really necessary? One of the other things I'd like you to do is go to the building department and say, do we really need to have two means of egress from an 8-suite or 6-suite apartment building? Because that one on the right is in Calgary and it doesn't. And we don't wake up every morning and hear about people burning to death in Calgary because they're living in 6-suite apartment buildings with one means of egress. But my point is, the most affordable housing we've got in the region are those little walk-up apartment buildings. Let's start to build them again. Nice, simple, plain, boxy buildings. The one thing that I compliment both Burnaby and Vancouver on was allowing this idea that we developed up at SFU. The idea, why not allow a basement suite in an apartment on the fifth floor by basically allowing another door into the bedroom and designing it so that the closet can be a little kitchenette. And these are quite successful. Now, thousands are not being built because right now the developers can build anything they want and they'd much rather build the things that they're used to. But this, to my mind, is a very creative way of building some rental housing in a condominium building. This week, a study came out by the Vancouver Home Builders Association, and it's a very good report and well worth reading. And one of the things they looked at is approval times in different municipalities. And we see these reports from NAOP and others. And you can't see that, but trust me, it varies from municipality to municipality. And some do much better than others. And I must say, I was delighted to see Kay Krishna here because I sat through a presentation she made a couple of weeks ago and I thought, great idea. She said, we need the equivalent of a nexus lane for qualified developers and architects who you can trust, basically. Those are my words, not hers. But people who understand, who are experienced, why do they all have to go through the same rigorous process? And it does. Even people who build laneway housing, they could have built dozens of laneway houses. And they tell me, I wouldn't name them, of course, but they tell me every laneway house is a whole new adventure. And they can have exactly the same plan, but if it goes through somebody else, they'll get different comments than they got the last time the plan. And I was discussing this with my wife and talking about this presentation, and she said, like, why don't you just have standardized plans, and everybody knows that if that's the plan, it can be approved right away? I said, that's a really innovative idea. I'm going to share it with everyone. So we also have to look at how we charge finance growth. I don't think developers complain about contributing towards the cost because the truth is we just pass it on. But the reality is these costs have been increasing, and indeed, this is an interesting chart from that Greater Vancouver Home Builder Association study where they looked at the fees in each municipality, and all these slides are available to anybody who wants them. We'll put them on the SFU website and so forth. But it was really interesting to see how the fees for a little house as part of a rezoning where you want to put two houses on one lot varied from $18,000 in Port Coquitlam to $61,000 in North Vancouver District. And I think that's because Brian Bidwell's no longer working in North Vancouver District, right? But it's wrong, you see, because that's $61,000 that gets added on, and I do believe it effectively it adds to the price. The other thing is the whole process. Have you ever really looked at the process that you have to go through? I didn't put that sticker on that rezoning sign, by the way. I saw that over in the downtown east side. But there are ways to simplify it. Indeed, I think Metro Vancouver municipalities should go out and spend some time in the Fraser Valley, because they're much more efficient in terms of the amount of time it takes. I found this chart, and I'll be honest, I thought it was those City Hall Watch people who put this together to make fun of the City of Vancouver. But it actually has a City of Vancouver logo on the bottom. It might actually be a chart put together by the City of Vancouver on how you go through the process to acquire community amenity. Anyway, I want to raise this one because Gil Kelly has raised it. Gil Kelly's the new director of planning in Vancouver. He came up from San Francisco. And although he doesn't really use the word inclusionary zoning, when I listen to him, I hear him saying this. Vancouver, as you know, has had inclusionary zoning, for those of you who are not familiar, is basically an American concept where basically you require somebody to build affordable housing as part of a development, whether residential, sometimes commercial, or make a payment in lieu to accommodate lower income people. The city of Seattle has recently developed a program which is a mandatory housing affordability program. And so if you're building condos or you're building office space in Seattle, you are now expected to make a contribution towards affordable housing. And you know, a lot of developers are going to be uncomfortable with this, but if the policy is rational, it may well be that there's some offsetting costs in other ways, it may well be something that people are willing to accept. But the fact is, this is an approach that is being used. It was applied in England. If Michael Mortensen was here, he'd say it was so effective it stopped the developers from building. So that is a worry too. But that brings us to the third sector, and we heard this term, Larry Beasley talked about it. It's the idea that it's not government, it's not the private sector, it's kind of the nonprofit sector, it's a variety of players, community land trusts. And again, when you go to Europe and England, a lot of this housing is being developed by this third sector and housing associations and so forth. And I often think you're creating, in a way, hybrid types of housing, in the sense that you've got this entity that's not public, it's not private. And I love this image of the fruit. But Community Land Trust, the City of Vancouver, is now promoting this. I hope other municipalities are looking at the possibility, doing it in conjunction with nonprofits, because then you could begin to introduce notions like shared equity. And for those of you who don't have a house but would like to buy some property, the way shared equity basically works is if you don't have $100,000 and $400,000, you buy half. So maybe you've got $50,000 and you take on a mortgage for $200,000 and you effectively are paying a kind of rent for the balance. Now, the total cost may be similar to the cost, but at least you're getting into the market with a lower down payment. It's a bit like rent to own. You remember when people used to rent to own televisions? But the point is, people are doing this all over Europe and Eastern United States now, and it's a very creative way. And again, people often say to me, well, if it's such a good idea, why is nobody doing it? And I say, you know, you're right, because here's another good idea. This is the Performing Arts Lodge at Bayshore. This was our non-market seniors component. There wasn't senior government funding, but Cameron Gray at the city got the site from us, and then he worked with a nonprofit society, he leased it to them. Then the nonprofit society went out and did some fundraising, and then they sold 12 life lease units. What does that mean? You don't actually get title to your unit like a condo, but what you get is the right to live in that unit as long as you want. And you get it at a price that's significantly below what it might have been if it was a market condo. But, and here's the but, in a condo, you may have to put down 20% down payment, which is held in trust by a lawyer until you purchase the completed unit. In the case of these life leases, you put up your $250,000 up front, and the society then used that as the equity to then go out and borrow the rest of the money. And then once they built the project, the rest of the units are subsidized low-income seniors housing. In the case of PAL, for performers, artists, musicians, and it's a fabulous model, and it should be copied everywhere. We're near the end. We cannot talk about housing affordability without talking about transit. And it troubles me when I see new homes being built in areas where you have to have two cars, because otherwise a family is not going to be able to get around. So thank God we're starting to see some progress since we started these talks when it comes to funding. And hopefully now we've got 40% from the feds and 40% from the province, and the province won't interfere when the mayor's council comes up with a creative way to generate the other 20%. And then we can start building more transit south of the river and up the Sea to Sky Highway, because I'm willing to bet that everyone in this room knows someone or knows someone who knows someone who's moved to Squamish or possibly Furry Creek or Pemberton, because that's a very attractive alternative. People are moving to Bowen Island. They would like to move to Maple Ridge, but there are no buses in too much of Maple Ridge. And so let's not forget that idea about False Creek and the private subsidy by all the residents to help subsidize a shuttle bus. And indeed, I met somebody recently who's in the high-tech business, and I said to her, how do you get your workers? I said, I heard in San Francisco, Google runs its own buses because their employees can't afford to live near the operation. And she said, we do the same thing in Vancouver. We bring buses in from Port Moody, because if you're not aware of it, Port Moody is the new Yale town. This is something I've always been interested in. I understand the rationale behind the empty homes tax. Like, it seems wrong if there's empty houses sitting there. Now, I have a problem because, as you know, it bothers me that people are living in $4 million condos and they live there 5 months a year and they're not there the other 7 months a year. We shouldn't be penalizing them just because they're rich. And that's what we're trying to do in the eyes of some people. That's not what we should be doing, but we should be making better use of the vacant stock. But one of the other things I've noticed is it's not just empty apartments. There's a lot of empty bedrooms throughout the region. So what we need to do, in my mind, is figure out a creative way to start matching those empty rooms and empty basement suites with the right tenants. And I Googled something, and I came up with this image of an entity called Rental Matchmaker that tries to bring together different people. And I mentioned this in a talk to the Fraser Valley homeowners, and somebody said there is a nonprofit out there working with seniors, because there's an opportunity for some seniors who are looking for homes to move in with other seniors who have homes. And to me, it just makes so much sense. Anyway, I wrote a column about it in the Courier, and I've pontificated about it. And I got a call from the Seattle Times, because somebody has a column there where he invites people to ask him questions. And one of the questions was, how many empty bedrooms are there in Seattle? So he started to do some research, and he found my column in the Courier. And based on that, we spent some time talking, and he wrote an article about it. But I don't think we should give up on this. And indeed, it's not just this. There's the whole potential to start dividing houses and more people sharing. I mean, the irony is, in the old days, we used to have things called boarding houses. Boarding room houses. They had a pejorative connotation, but that was the affordable form of accommodation. And indeed, I think we should be rethinking how can we get more people to share. Well, one way is to change NIMBY to YIMBY. And Mayor Stewart and I once delivered a NIMBY presentation to the Lower Mainland Government Officials, is that what it's called, conference. We did. He gave the public sector perspective on how to address NIMBYs, and I gave a private sector perspective, and everybody cheered when he spoke, and everybody booed when I spoke. So now I'm on to YIMBYs. This is a movement. Who got to hear Sonia Trauss when she was here last week? Yeah. So it's very interesting. And, you know, not everybody thinks it's wonderful. A lot of people worry that she's in the pockets of developers and so forth. But she's not alone. Across America now, YIMBY movements are forming in most major cities. And indeed, I found that there's actually a conference this past year in Boulder, Colorado, for YIMBY groups to come together and talk about their successes and failures. And I think the reality is that we do need all of us to, I mean, not me, but many people who often sit by the sidelines and feel that projects should get built, you need to rethink how you're going to behave. When Sonia was here, she made a very interesting comment at a breakfast meeting I attended. She says, "You developers think it's a bummer when your project gets rejected." Well, to tell you the truth, I think it's a bummer too if 200 people who might have got new rental apartments don't have anywhere to live. So it's a kind of an interesting thought. So to conclude, pull this all together, land is too expensive. And even if we can gently densify and intensively densify, we're not going to create really cheap housing on residentially zoned land in most parts of Metro, unless it's such a dramatic increase where you do put up that 5 FSR building on a single family lot. Then, of course, you can bring down the cost. So we have to do that, but not be naive to believe that that will solve all our problems. We have to bring back a lot of these government programs or figure out ways to create new government programs to take the role that these programs played in the past. The federal provincial funding, the assisted rental program, the support for co-ops, programs to entice dentists and doctors to invest in rental housing. We also have to recognize that even if we do bring down the cost, we won't necessarily bring down the price. So we have to ensure there's adequate supply and competition, because then if we bring down costs, the prices will come down. And municipalities have to play a role. And so I tried to find a picture of Metro Vancouver. Is that the Metro Vancouver boardroom there? That's what I hoped. So I'm not picking on anybody. I'm picking on all of you. Because you do have a role. And we are making progress. I actually do feel the pendulum is now starting to swing in the other direction. And we are starting to see more conversation about how the nonprofits can work with the developers and work with the government and start looking at alternative forms of tenure. I really am more optimistic now than I was last year when I gave this talk, in large part because we're even going to get some money for transit, because we can't discuss affordable housing without transit. And then if we can take all of these ideas and buoy them with a YIMBY movement that shows up at council, because most politicians are intelligent enough to know what is the right thing to do, but they're not so stupid that when 15 people say, this is wrong, they're not going to vote in favor of it unless 15 other people come forward, or at least 10, and say, this is right. And so that's why I'd finish off with this, because I think it's so very important. Anyway, I hope I've given you something to think about. Thank you very much. That was much too long. I apologize. Questions? We've got a microphone. If Lance Borelowitz, get up there and get this started. Lance Borelowitz is a long-standing planning consultant.
What have I done wrong tonight, Michael? I just want to mention that I live in a very interesting townhouse development in Mount Pleasant called The Block. I'm actually the strata president. And interestingly enough, just a minor correction, there are two legal rental units in that townhouse development. They're both basement units, and I believe that they were created at the request, in fact, the demand of the city at the time, to replace affordable housing that was demolished as part of that development. But that's a classic example, I think, of what we should and could be doing more of in Vancouver, where we had 8 single-family lots on standard 33-foot wide lots, single-family houses, and we've converted that into 32 townhouse strata units and 2 rental units. And we could get the cost down even lower than, say, 30% below the equivalent single-family house in this neighborhood if we would reduce the parking requirement that the city insists on of 2 stalls per unit. So I think that's one of the key challenges is, and you mentioned that, is one of the key incremental costs is $50,000 per stall for underground parking. That is a big one. I don't really have a question. I just had that to say.
No, that's good. So Cameron, I'm going to put you on the spot. You don't have to come to the microphone. So I want to thank Cameron Gray. How many years were you director of housing with the City of Vancouver?
Almost
20 years. So what should we be doing? Which of the things do you violently disagree with, and which of the things am I on the right track?
Well, certainly densification of the single family neighborhood with more forms of family-oriented housing, adult-oriented housing in particular. I disagree with you. I've always corrected you about CACs. They do not get passed on to purchasers. They are a profit sharing by municipalities and neighborhoods. But that's a debate that can go on forever. The reality is we have to do the YIMBY thing. We have to accept more density. Single family neighborhoods should become just family neighborhoods. So I think most of what you got there is right. It's just one of those things where you just have to keep on keeping on. It's not a short-term solution. There is no silver bullet. It's going to take decades. And that's just the way this business is.
So Brian Bidwell, you're no longer the director of planning, so you can speak now. So in North Shore, what are some of the things that are happening there? Maybe you can go to the microphone. What are some of the things that you see are starting to happen now that weren't happening 5 years ago, and what are the things that you think should happen?
Well, thanks for putting me on the spot, Michael. Actually, I'm going to throw a question
you
back.
You can no longer turn down my application.
Yeah. I'm going to throw a question back at you, and I guess just on the sort of the theme of inclusionary zoning. And if we accept that prices are reaching a maximum, whether it's in Coquitlam or in the North Shore or Surrey, and whether it's a one-bedroom, a two-bedroom, a three-bedroom, if we go to inclusionary zoning, does that not have an effect of actually pushing down the value of the land? So I don't see that necessarily as increasing the price of the product because you won't be able to sell it. But I think there's a lot of people who are probably unfairly profiting by the land value. So is that a way of actually tackling how much land is selling for?
So this is a constant discussion, and it goes back to some degree with the CAC conversation, that if you impose these additional requirements, will it bring down the value of the land rather than simply increase the price? And I think it depends. And I think it depends on whether or not the market can bear increases in price. And the irony is, for reasons that I've never understood, the market seems to constantly be willing to accept higher and higher prices. If you had told me a couple of years ago that $1,200 a foot would become the norm in the West End, I'd say that's impossible. But somehow or other, because interest rates are low at the moment, people are accepting it. If interest rates start to go up, things could change. So the reason why I think inclusionary zoning may not be as terrible as some might think is if some of those other financial contributions, like the CACs or some of the other fees that are being paid, if they can effectively be replaced, it may work. And I don't think it will be a bad thing if it does bring down the price of land. The interesting thing, though, is you cannot bring the value of that single family lot down below what it's worth as a single family lot. So then the question is, how much of a premium is acceptable in order to get someone to sell their dream home on Knight Street at 39th, to sell that home so that it could be redeveloped with townhouses or apartments? What we've seen in Vancouver is quite astounding. Single-family lots on Cambie and Oak Street that at one time were worth 1.5, then they got up to 2, and then when they got rezoned, they suddenly were worth 4. And I was looking at some land assessments in the city of North Vancouver, in the Moodyville area, where just putting the OCP in place has dramatically increased the value of those land. So already, you do a pro forma, those townhouses have to sell for $700 a square foot. Now, the question is if there was more land zoned for townhouses, would that perhaps have a dampening effect on the value of the land? And I think it would. I think it would. But the benchmark, the starting point, is always the value of the land as single-family land. And that's why, well, I think we should densify single-family neighborhoods. It will create alternative housing choices. It will free up older houses and so forth. We're not going to get really low, you know, priced accommodation when you're starting at $2 million for a 50-foot lot. Patrick. Patrick Condon is, the Thai keeps referring to you as the head of the Masters in Urban Design program at the School of Architecture and Landscape Architecture.
Yes, that's right. And thanks for the invitation to tell you that you were wrong on one thing.
Good.
Which is lower than your usual average, but... I'm curious, after looking at your presentation, which I was with you the whole way, where you're showing demonstrations of housing types that are generally around the 0.9 to 1.5 FSR, and then you disappointed me at the very end where you said, but single-family lots don't pencil out unless you get to 5 FSR. Yeah. I first of all, I don't agree with you, but why do you make that claim, and why do you present to us those models, which at the end of your lecture, this you say, oh, but they can't work anyway because the land is too expensive.
Yeah. Well, I didn't really feel, that's a fair comment. I didn't dwell, excuse me, on on a lot of the higher density, other than some of the images, the higher density development, but that is happening in Marple. I mean, I had pictures of Burnaby. I mean, I can't believe what's happening in Burnaby. Coquitlam, what's your tallest building in Coquitlam now? 49 stories are there, about?
Yeah.
Burnaby is going to, you know, so it's starting. So yes, we do need, but the problem I see is, I guess if there was an underlying theme, it is I'm still in this, how do you more gently increase the density in a lot of areas rather than the dramatic marine gateways and things like that that are happening. They are happening. I mean, what's interesting is the Cambie Street corridor. I mean, there's a case study for everybody studying planning. The city came up with one of the most impressive planning documents. It sets out a whole range of densities for almost site by site, and then it doesn't rezone all the land. Doesn't change the zoning. So every one of those buildings on the Cambie corridor is a separate rezoning. Think of all the staff time that goes into that. Think of all the council time that goes into it. They nearly always get approved at the end of the day. It's crazy. The other thing is, initially the policy was inclusionary zoning, that a certain percentage of the units had to be rental units. And then the city backed off on that, so we'll just take $55 a foot and we'll build rental housing with that. But apparently the rental housing, there's one private rental project. So the higher density, you're right, that does help. But we need enough of it, because otherwise all that happens is it goes from $2 million to $6 million.
Right, and that's my follow-up question. So therefore, as you've correctly identified the problem with isolated rezonings or quasi-rezonings, where in the case of Cambie Street, the city indicates an intention to upzone, and then they further create difficulties because they don't actually upzone. They require a zoning variance for every building that goes in, even though it's in conformance with the city's stated intentions. And the inflationary aspect that creates relative to land values doubling and tripling along that one corridor. Do you therefore agree that in order to eliminate that likelihood, we need a citywide zoning where we pre-zone to eliminate that inflationary factor and to eliminate those costs of processing permits and all the problems that you've described?
Yeah. Well, of course, the answer is yes. The irony is that we're using this word, pre-zone. What you mean as a professor of planning is zone. Just zone properly. I'll send you a copy of my article called Why Municipal Planners Improperly Zone Land. Other questions? Sir?
Yes, comments? Sir. Enjoyed your presentation. Stuart Hogan from Maplewood Community Association in the District of North Vancouver. I'm wondering about your thoughts on assisted rental versus rental control. We are rezoning Maplewood completely. We're going to tear it down and build it from scratch. And, you know, there's a lot of tenants and lifetime residents that are renters, much like the ones that you've described in your presentation, that are going to be displaced. And they've sent me here to take in your presentation and learn as much as I can and go back and talk to Dan Milburn tomorrow at the District of North Vancouver about what their lives are going to look like in the future. So the question is assisted rental versus rental
market
control.
Yeah, or whatever. Well, I think it's one of the biggest dilemmas that we face, which is many of the prime redevelopment opportunities are older rental buildings. And they offer relatively low rent to relatively low-income people in many instances. Some people are just there to take advantage. And the question is, if we could get a supply of new rental units and then figure out a way of almost moving people from the old units into the new units, and those who can't afford the new units provide and are truly in need to provide rent supplements or rent subsidies to them. In other words, don't forget that old CMHC debate of do you subsidize the individual or subsidize the project. There might be a bit of an answer there. I've often wondered whether or not the modular housing or creating a stock of, like schools. Remember with schools, when the school expanded and there weren't enough classrooms, they brought in portables. And then when they built the new school, they moved out the portables and they moved them somewhere else. And that was my thesis about but using housing instead of portables that you move around on vacant land. But I think there, you know, in the case of the rental housing we did in West Van, we had a conversation, is it enough just to provide new market rental? And the consensus was no. In the case of West Van, you had to do more. Now in the city of Vancouver, they've generally accepted if you can get some new rental units, that in itself is a good thing. But then you do have to look at how are you going to make more subsidized rental units? How do you make them available? Who chooses the tenants? Who's going to manage? And I'm not joking when I say the legal agreements to work out a lot of that is sometimes even more complex than the basic decision.
Indeed.
So are you demolishing older rental housing to create new rental housing, or are you just building on
completely
vacant land or underdeveloped land?
They're going to remove the old development and replace it. So right now we have the ability to have a dialogue with the developers and possibly even compel them by law to build new accommodation first and move the tenants before they have at the...
Okay. Well, I don't think you're going to get the answer that you wanted now, although I see
I think.
A prominent mayor getting up to the microphone. He may tell us how they do it in Coquitlam. But there's another comment, sir. Yes.
Please go ahead. Oh, thanks. Hi, my name's Mike, and I know there are a lot of urban planners here, so my next question will probably get me tossed out of my ear. But the city of Houston, in their town charter, very much cuts the wings off of urban planners and zoning laws, and it has created a situation where their market adaptively responds to, say, population increases or near zero interest rates. You know, they just build more housing. Could such an approach be tried here in Metro Vancouver, perhaps in special economic zones or no zoning zones, you know, where we could try out this experiment, see what the market would actually do if you would, say, chop the zoning people out?
Well, some people would say, when you look at what some of the developers get to do, we don't have zoning in Vancouver either.
Well, just, you know, to cut off, you know, that bureaucracy. So, like,
no,
you build here.
No, I'm only being facetious, of course. Well, we have a lot of discussion about whether or not there's lessons to be learned from Houston. American planners talk about it all the time. The interesting thing is, a lot of Houston has developed, though, in very somewhat similar patterns to many other American cities that do have zoning. But, I mean, I think the key thing is actually what Patrick Condon suggested, which is we need to have, at least in Vancouver, an overall city plan. That would help us in Vancouver. But other municipalities do have overall community plans. Richmond, Coquitlam, they do have community plans which are much more definitive. The only thing is they don't zone the land. Very often there's an overall community plan, but you still have to go through the process with all of the rezoning and the development application. And I remember sitting in Richmond Council watching councillors discussing the height of a fence. You know, and they get into minutiae of detail related to development permits because the process requires that. It's crazy. As somebody said the other day, we still have to advertise rezoning applications in the newspaper. Who reads the newspaper?
Well, I guess for Houston is I bring that up as an example is because they've been able to avoid, you know, like affordability crunches, and also they've been able to avoid the American housing bubble as well. So I think maybe that alone, you know, demonstrates the validity of our approach like that. Certainly, you know, we don't want to like roll it out over all of Metro Vancouver, but maybe in experimental zones, just like China has special economic zones before they went totally capitalist.
Well, I suspect it will turn out, it'll happen in Chilliwack or Abbotsford before it'll happen in Metro Vancouver, but it's an interesting provocation. I'm glad you raised it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mayor Stewart?
Good day. My name is Richard. I work in the mayor's office in Coquitlam, and I want to defend newspapers because if municipalities didn't have to advertise, they'd all collapse. You made some points, and it's like you were trying to decide what it was that was causing this challenge that we're facing now, and I struggle with the same one. Is it a shortage of land? I don't think so. I think it's actually a shortage of SkyTrain stations and a shortage of really good planners, because if we had more, if we had access to more, we as municipalities would probably be able to approve faster. We wouldn't approve the way you suggest, because we can't extract if we pre-zone.
Do you want to say that again for the benefit of those people who don't understand what you're saying? Of course you can. You just say this area has a development cost levy of $28 a square foot.
That's not the extraction I meant. I meant council does want to raise their legs on design issues as well.
Oh, I see. Yes. Because you are all planners and architects, right?
No, because some of you aren't very good. But anyway, our big challenge in Coquitlam, and I know it's the same in many of the suburbs, is the 7,000 square foot lot, the quarter acre gross density. It's easier to simply redevelop it as 6,000 square feet in one unit with seven basement suites or something, that most of which are illegal, than it is to go through the rezoning process. And it's largely because we don't have any ability to influence the non-rezoning redevelopment of a site. We have housing choices. We have all kinds of things we can do on a single family lot now in Coquitlam, but they're not being taken up because it's easier to build the monster house than it is to go through a process to get there. And that's among the challenges. We certainly are doing the not so gentle density around SkyTrain stations, and we now have five new ones. So it really has opened things up in the Tri-Cities. But our challenge still, I think our bigger challenge is the vast majority of our land that's quarter acre gross density. And we're having, we've presented the options, we can't get them to take it up.
Well, I'll give you all these slides, which you can share with some of your local builders, and
We tell them what they can do, and they always come back with, yeah, but can I still build a monster?
So. Yeah, anyway. Well, I think, Andy, with that, it's probably a good point to end it up. I gather I'd like to call on Councillor Adrian Carr, who's going to give you a 50 or 60 minute response to everything I said from the perspective of a councillor of the City of Vancouver who's been to every one of these talks, and very few people come three times, so I really appreciate it.
no, it's no 50 or 60 minutes, actually more like 50 or 60 seconds. My job is really to thank Michael. But first, I just want to thank all of you for coming, and I particularly want to thank Andy Yan and the Simon Fraser University for the Housing Affordability Redux lecture series. I mean, yes, I come to them, and I come to them because largely probably why all you come to them. And it's a measure of your impact and your and the enticing way in which you present new ideas, Michael, that has elected politicians on their nights off, supposedly, coming out, people from the universities, the students, the professionals, coming to hear you talk. I mean, you are a force in this field, and I really thank you for that. I do have to say, however, there was one thing I thought you missed in your 9 points. You know, in Vancouver, we're undergoing a housing reset right now, and it is a crisis here. It's a crisis in all our municipalities across the region, but we feel it on a daily basis in Vancouver, and it's deep and it's growing. And you didn't talk about the force of the global market, of foreign capital, and I don't think we can afford to not talk about that and how we can grapple with that in terms of creating supply that can become affordable. So other than that one slight, you know, addendum, everything else, including your history, which of course it makes me salivate to think of those housing programs the federal government used to run, and I hope will again, because cities can't do it on our own, regions can't do it on our own. We need senior government help in terms of those programs. So thank you again all for coming, but Michael, for your insights, for sharing your wisdom, your experience, the breadth of experience you have, and your challenging and innovative ideas.